So starting today, the upper respiratory tract infection. Let's go to the first question. C. diphtheriae may be difficult to isolate from the nasopharynx without the use of special media. And the medium of choice is sheep blood agar, Loeffler serum slope or Loeffler's medium, Thayer Martin, thiosulfate citrate, thiosulfate sucrose medium, and Lowenstein Jensen medium. So what do you feel is the answer? Then is B, Loeffler serum slope. Where do we use TCBS?
TCBS in Vibrio.
It's a selective medium for Vibrio. And what about Thayer Martin? It's a selective medium for Neisseria, gram-negative diplococci. Okay, going to next question. 17-year-old girl presents with cervical lymphadenopathy, fever, and pharyngitis. Infectious mononucleosis is suspected. The most rapid and clinically useful test to make this diagnosis is IgM antibody to viral core antigen, IgG to viral core antigen, antibody to Epstein-Barr nuclear antigen, culture, and C-reactive protein. What would you like to choose? So if we go on ruling out, then what happens is IgG and CRP are clear cut out, correct? Because that's a remote infection, and CRP is at such a prognostic test. Culture, obviously, for viruses, it's not a practical option. The only confusing point is EBNA and VCIgM. But EBNA antibody takes longer time. It takes around 2 to 3 months to appear. So the answer is IgM antibody. Okay. So infectious mononucleosis is the disease that is caused by Epstein-Barr virus. And under which family do we classify Epstein-Barr virus?
Herpes.
Herpes, correct. So it belongs to herpes viridae family. Generally, the disease is predominant in young adults, and many a times it can be just an asymptomatic times. It can be in the form of pharyngitis associated with fever, associated with weakness. So this classical symptomatology of infectious mononucleosis if the person is not asymptomatic. Now, Epstein-Barr virus has only one serotype, but it may have different genotypes. So, what I mean by it is, if you try and isolate genes, say, do nucleic acid study or PCR, then you will find different genotypes of Epstein-Barr. But all of them produce a single type of antibody, which is cross-reactive. Yeah. So, there is only one serotype. And we know age-old test, Paul Bunnell test, which is heterophile agglutination test, you know, where antibodies are cross-reactive with human and guinea pig kidney and sheep RBC and all those things. But again, it's not a practical test. It takes a long time. You require so many different gradients for the test. And we have better tests based on nucleic acid study or serological test. So we don't go ahead with Paul Bunnell test anymore. Also, the population in which the infectious mononucleosis is common is young adult. But many a times Paul Bunnell test has a very low sensitivity, around just 30 to 60%. So as such also, it is of no use. So we don't go ahead with that. Now, apart from infectious mononucleosis, the Epstein-Barr virus causes Burkitt's lymphoma and nasopharyngeal carcinoma, especially of the patients of Chinese origin. Okay. The next question is, which of the following does not cause mononucleosis-like disease? The options are Epstein-Barr, cytomegalovirus, Coxsackie, and Toxoplasma gondii. Do you have any idea? The answer is C, Coxsackie. Actually, 10% of infectious mononucleosis cases are caused by cytomegalovirus. Generally, we say that infectious mononucleosis has to be Epstein-Barr, but it is just 90% of the cases. 10% are caused by cytomegalovirus, and even toxoplasma has similar type of presentation. Toxoplasma as such is important in HIV seropositive patient, where in immunocompromised condition it leads to severe retinitis, then encephalitis, or in the other group where the infection is may present in a very severe form is a transplacental infection, so congenital toxoplasmosis. So apart from these two, if we see the spectrum of symptoms, then sometimes it may lead to mononucleosis like disease. So answer here is coxsackie. The next question, 30-year-old female presented with chronic granulomatous inflammation or swelling like a lumpy mass as shown in the picture. On histopathological examination of immune cells were seen. What could be the causative organism? Did you see this? The typical red, inflamed, lumpy type of nose? Yes. So the options, staph, Klebsiella rhinosclerotomatis, rhinosporidium and pseudomonas. Answer is?
Klebsiella.
So this particular condition is called as rhinoscleroma. Okay. It's a chronic condition. Generally, when it starts, it begins in the age group 20 to 30. And there is a lot of recurrence. Sometimes it needs surgical removal, and long-term antibiotic treatment is required in order to control the infection and also in order to prevent the recurrences. Okay, we go ahead with the next question. Most common cause of sinusitis: Streptopneumoniae, Haemophilus influenzae, Streptococcus pyogenes, or Mycoplasma pneumoniae.
Streptococcus pneumoniae.
Correct. So take any upper respiratory tract infection, whether it is otitis media, pharyngitis, sinusitis, most common is Streptococcus pneumoniae. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Then, 45-year-old man presents with the sensation of blockage of nose. On examination, polyp was observed in the right nasal cavity. Pathology shows following findings. So you can see here what is the histopathology. Okay. Should we go ahead?
Yes, ma'am.
What is the probable diagnosis?
Rhinosporidium sieveri.
Right. Quite clear. It's Rhinosporidium sieveri. Okay. Which of the following is false about rhinosporidiosis? Infection is transmitted by droplet nuclei. It is endemic in India and Sri Lanka. It can be cultivated in cell-free medium. It is a subcutaneous fungal infection. Okay, let's go one by one. You feel D. Okay, what about C? It can be cultivated in cell-free medium?
No, it cannot be cultivated.
It cannot be. So this option is true. Endemic in India and Sri Lanka?
Yes, yes.
Okay, do you know which patients or which people are more prone to develop rhinosporidiosis? So the source lies where? It's in water.
Water.
The infection is waterborne. So can it be transmitted by droplet nuclei?
No.
Infection is not transmitted by droplet nuclei because the site of localization is nose or sometimes saliva. You know, we feel like, yes, it is by droplet nuclei, but it's not so. It's mostly by inoculation. And washermen are at risk. Farmers is one. But basically those who come in contact with the ponds and water and all those, they are more prone to develop the infection. And yes, obviously rhinosporidium is a subcutaneous fungal infection. Okay. The organism responsible for a clinical case having foul smelling nasal discharge and atopic rhinitis is
Klebsiella ozini.
Very good. So answer is Klebsiella ozini. Okay. Characteristic colony morphology for Graves type of Corynebacterium diphtheriae is what? And what about Medusa head?
Bacillus
anthracis.
Then cartwheel?
No idea.
No idea. Okay. And Daisy head?
It is reverse.
Daisy head is for Graves.
Graves
is Daisy head. Intermediate is frog egg, and mitis is poached egg. All right.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Next, which of the following is not true about Corynebacterium diphtheriae? Toxicity or toxicity testing rather is important part in lab diagnosis. Toxin acts by inhibition of cyclic AMP. Toxin production is dependent on critical concentration of iron, and potassium telluride is an indicator medium. They have asked what is not true. So what happens here is there are many bacteria which are gram-positive bacilli, which morphologically appear to be like Corynebacteria, and they are commensal of throat. We call respiratory organisms. All right. So that's why we do Albert staining or Neisser staining, that we are able to differentiate Corynebacterium from diphtheroids. Next, what happens is when once we isolate and we prove that the organism is not diphtheroid, it is Corynebacterium diphtheriae only, there is a possibility that the organism could be present in the throat, but it may not have Tox plus gene. And therefore, the clinical presentation is not of diphtheria, but of some other infection, most probably pyogenous. So just identifying organism, merely identifying organism is not enough. You need to prove that particular strain is able to produce toxin. That is why the subcutaneous and intracutaneous, that is in vivo type of testing, and in vitro, the LX gel or nowadays tissue culture or ELISA, these are very important a part of lab diagnosis. So obviously option A is true. I don't find D is also, you know, not,
B is true.
It is also true. So what remains is toxin acts by inhibition of cyclic AMP. Inhibition of cyclic AMP occurs in case of Vibrio or LT, labile toxin. How does the exotoxin of Corynebacterium diphtheriae acts as? Do you have any idea? It acts on elongation factor 2 and inhibits protein synthesis. That's the mechanism of action of C. diphtheriae.